God of Jacob, whose love endures through generations. I know that you will keep your covenant. I'm calling on the God of Moses, the one who opened up the ocean. I need you now to do the same thing for me. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Oh, rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness. I'm calling on the God of Mary, whose favor rests upon the lowly. I know with you all things are possible. I'm calling on the God of David, who made a shepherd boy courageous. I may not face Goliath, but I've got my own giants. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Oh rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness. You heard your children, you hear your children now. You are the same God, you are the same God. You answered prayers back then, and you will answer now. You are the same God, you are the same God. You were provider then, you are providing now. You are the same God, you are the same God. You moved in power then, God move in power now. You are the same God, you are the same God. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Oh rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now.
Good morning, friends. The Lord be with you. It's a joy to welcome you to worship as we come and offer our praise to the God that Scott is singing about, the one who is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. The God of David, the God of Mary, the God of you and me as we gather together. We're here to offer him our praise and our thanksgiving, to remember who he is and therefore know whose we are. So we're glad to be together. For those who are here in the sanctuary, please find the blue friendship pads, sign them and pass them down the pew. We'd love to know you were here. Those who are online, we'd love for you to sign on the virtual friendship pad so we know that you are with us this morning also. I wanted to highlight a few things that are going on, as well as the prayer list that is in your bulletin for those who are here. There are three different inserts. One is the prayer list. The other two, if you have a college student or somebody that we would like to keep in touch with, a young adult, please use that form and fill it out with their contact information so that we can keep in touch with them in this season of their life. It's such an important time of our formation. Once we leave, if you will, that high school experience, and maybe even leave home and go away. So we want to, as a church family, maintain that relationship as we are able. But we need that information, so please provide that. The second insert is to remind you that next Sunday there's a blood drive down in Fellowship Hall. If you are able to give, there's a great shortage, and I know that they would appreciate that. You can sign up and register online if you wish. In the announcements of the bulletin, Pam Dudgeon asked me to highlight the evening with Prism that is this Friday. So please read that information. You could reach out to Pam if you are interested at all in being a part of that mission partnership with international students, and it would be great. Also, for your preparation, in two Sundays, on March 27th, there will be a pancake breakfast in Fellowship Hall all morning that Sunday from 9 until 1. I think it's a great idea. I'm just not sure how we're going to worship with the smell of pancakes going on. It'll be a great thing for us to leave worship and go down and have breakfast, or people to come to breakfast and then up to worship. But please prepare for that also. A few things that I ask you to pray for. One is the search team for the Director of Children and Family Ministries. Two, please remember to continue to pray for our world, and specifically the folks of Ukraine and all of those who are around that place now that are receiving those refugees and people who are fleeing into their homes and caring for them. It's really a wonderful opportunity for God to do amazing things. But I also wanted to update you on the prayer list. So if you could pull your prayer list out, I'd appreciate that. Please note the new information for Tannen Loopy. That would be Mike's grandson. It's not necessarily encouraging information, but there was a biopsy that showed more cancer for this little guy. And so the doctors have recommended palliative and hospice care. It's not an easy thing to receive for one so young, 3-4 years old. So please keep that family in your prayers. On the other side, you will see Dick Stewart's information there. This Friday afternoon, I'll be with the family down at the National Cemetery of the Alleghenies doing the interment for Dick. So please keep the Stewart family in your prayers also. Yesterday, I led a memorial service for Kim Dallow. Kim is the husband of Sandy, and I know Kim through Boy Scouts, and he was connected with several members of this church. So please keep Sandy, his widow, and the family in your prayers also. It was a wonderful celebration yesterday. A few prayer requests that are not on this prayer list that if you could add. Received a text from Gloria George's daughter that Gloria fell and fractured two ribs and her patella. And she is at home still, and the children are taking care of her. But please remember Gloria in your prayers. Also, if you could lift up our brother Bob Wegner. He has been in the hospital with back pain and is looking forward to surgery this week. This will be number 3 on his back. He's in a great deal of pain, so please keep him in your prayers. Also, at the same time, his mother has received a date for surgery, the cancer that she has, on March 30th. So you can remember to pray for Linda. That's Bob Wegner's mother also. It's great to have Don Dawson with us to help lead worship this morning. We welcome him back, and it's great to have Scott here to lead us in the musical part of it and offer his gifts. And it's good to be here with one another. So let's take a moment. Just stand. Don't go and hug anybody. Just stand and greet everybody with the peace of Christ this morning. Peace of Christ be with you. It's good to be together, friends, both in person and online. We're glad to be here. Just so we're aware and we're prepared, it could be that about 9:20, people will be walking in. So be kind and gracious. You set your alarms. They may not have last night. That is okay. And I'm sure with the live stream, we'll have a lot of people live streaming at 9:30 this morning. Anyway. Let's come to the Lord with our offerings of praise and use the words from Psalm 95 as our call to worship. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker.
For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care.
Let's stand together and sing our opening hymn.
Sing, Lord.
pray together. God, we have just sung that you are with us always and everywhere, that there is nowhere that we can go that you are not present with us. What a comfort, what a peace that gives to us. Thank you for your love that is so faithful, that nothing can separate us from it, that love that we know in Jesus. For your mercies and your grace that receive us with forgiveness and kindness. For your Holy Spirit that provides us assurance in days that are full of doubt. For the ability to trust a sovereign God in a world that is full of chaos and uncertainty. Thank you for that joy and peace. As we bring our prayers of thanksgiving, as we lift our songs in praise, we ask that you would be honored and glorified. Help us focus the eyes of our heart, the eyes of our mind upon you this day, and upon the gift you have provided in your Son, the Savior, who is Jesus. We do it for your glory. We pray in his name. Amen. Seated. One of the joys of Lent for me is this practice that we have continued of having this song of confession as a different twist in our order of service. So please look at the bulletin. Ron's going to lead us in singing, and we'll bring our confession to God.
Please join me.
For what we have done and left undone, we fall on your countless mercies. For sins that are known and those unknown, we call on your name so holy. For envy and pride, for closing our eyes, for scorning
us to just close our eyes for a brief moment of silent prayer of confession and just think personally in your own life. Those things that you have done that require the mercy of God. Those things that have been done in anger or out of frustration. Those words that have been said that are hurtful. those actions that aren't thoughtful of others but are self-motivated or centered. And just lay them before God right now, knowing that He's kind and merciful, willing to forgive. Bring them and make your confession to the Lord. Now let's remember all of those things that we have done that were wrong. Perhaps the things that we haven't done that we should have. Words that we could have offered to bring peace or hope or love into a circumstance. All of those failures and shortcomings, all of that sin is covered in the blood of Jesus. God has provided the Lamb of God, a Savior. The one who took upon himself my sin and yours and the sin of the world so that we might live in that love for God and one another. It's free in that it's gracious, but it was costly in that it took Jesus to the cross. He willingly gave himself out of love for his Father and for us, his people. Died a death that was full of suffering so that we might know the joy and hope of salvation in Him.
Please join me.
For what you have done, your life of love, you perfectly lived, we praise you. Though tempted and tried, you fixed your eyes. You finished the work God gave you. And there on the tree, a king among thieves, you bled for a world's betrayal. You loved to the end, our merciful friend, how deeply we need a Savior.
Beloved, the good news is this, that while we were yet sinners, Christ gave himself for us that we might know the love of God. Believe the good news. Receive it into your heart. Live it out in your life. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
As we come bringing our offerings to our Lord, let us pray. O good and gracious God, we thank you that in your sovereign love for us, you give us the opportunity to participate in your kingdom. And so, O Lord, for the privilege of being able to share of our time, our talents, and our money, we thank you. And as we present now our offerings, we present the fullness of ourselves, that we might serve you in all that we do, and that you might be given all the honor and glory through Christ our Lord. Amen.
This chip on my shoulder feels like a mountainside. Trying to climb it, but it's way too high. Been pointing my finger with a log in my own eye. It's like forgiveness in short supply. It keeps breaking up, it keeps breaking down. I need a stronger love right now. Don't have the answers, I'm just tired of picking sides. Done drawing these battle lines. Could our conversations look less like picket signs? 'Cause we're not alone. It keeps breaking up, it keeps breaking down. I need a stronger love right now. It keeps breaking up, it keeps breaking down. I need a stronger love right now. I try to feed that flame, it keeps burning out. I need a stronger love right now. It keeps breaking up, it keeps breaking down. I need a stronger love right now. Try to feed that flame, it keeps burning out. I need a stronger love right now. This chip on my shoulder feels like a mountainside. Trying to climb it, but it's way too high. It keeps breaking up, it keeps breaking down. I need a stronger love right now. I try to feed that flame, it keeps burning out. I need a stronger love right now.
Please remain standing so that we might affirm our faith and say what we believe using the Nicene Creed. Please join me. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father.
Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated. Let us join together in offering to God our prayers of thanksgiving and intercession. Let us pray. Lord God Almighty, we bring you our praise and thanks this day that you are the same yesterday and today and forever. That you are the Almighty and in control is the source of our hope and our confidence. And it allows us to go forward and live each day in power and in grace and in love. And so, Lord, we give you thanks first and foremost for who you are and how you draw us unto yourself. And we give you thanks this day for the joy of being able to come together in worship and fellowship. Oh God, how much that means to us, that we can acknowledge who you are and we can commit ourselves to you and we can be refreshed by the power of your Spirit. Thank you for giving us this rhythm of life that every Lord's Day, we can come into your presence together and be nurtured by your Holy Spirit. And that we can also be nurtured by the gift of relationship with one another. Thank you for the strengthening that comes through the fellowship of the church that enables us to keep going on even when things are difficult. Oh God, thank you specifically for this church, for Elfinwild, and for the oneness of this community of faith, and for the way in which this congregation reaches out and brings your presence into this community, touches those who do not know you with your love, drawing them unto yourself. Thank you, O Lord, for the gift of this church and this community. And we pray for this church, O God, that you might reign in all things as the session meets tonight, as the search begins for a director for children and family ministries. Oh God, that you might be the one who guides and directs, and it might be your glory that is sought after in every decision. So it is, we pray for this church and pray also for the church universal, for brothers and sisters in Christ who worship around the world. We pray, oh Lord, for people in far-reaching places like Vietnam or Niger or Ukraine, where even in the midst of war, some are gathered this day to worship you. Oh Lord, hear the prayers of your faithful people everywhere. And we ask, O Lord, that in the midst of this troubled world, you might bring peace. We pray it especially for the people of Ukraine as we see that tragedy lived out day after day, and the pain and suffering, for the refugees who stream out of the country and don't know what's next, for those who huddle in fear in makeshift bomb shelters. Oh Lord, we ask that you might have mercy and that you might bring peace somehow in the midst of this, that you might change minds and hearts, that you might accomplish what to all of us seems like it's not much of a possibility, to end this war. And that in your sovereignty, O Lord, as you bring peace to this area of the world and to all places that live in conflict this day, that the one who is the Prince of Peace might be lifted up as the one who is able to reconcile people when everything else seems unreconcilable. O Prince of Peace, we ask that you might use us too to be peacemakers in our own lives, in our own circle of influence, that we might help individuals to be reconciled one to another, that we might help those who are our friends or our co-workers to have a sensitivity to those with whom they are at odds, that they might be willing to listen and try to understand and seek that more than being understood themselves. Oh Lord, bring reconciliation in every place. And oh Lord, now we intercede also for all of those with health needs or needs for comfort because of grief, all of those named on our list for prayer, that you, O God, might be especially with Gloria and with Bob Wagner and with his mother, who have current needs that are particularly strong. But for everyone named here, O Lord, you might hear our prayers, that you might be the one who provides comfort to the Loopy family as well, and that you might be the one who strengthens us and strengthens each individual that we name before you. So hear our prayers, O Lord. Hear us as we pray in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus, who taught us when we pray to pray together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Friends, our scripture this morning again comes from the book of Galatians chapter 5. You might just want to put a little bookmark there because that's where we'll be for the next several weeks. It's page 1095 in your pew Bible, Galatians 5, 22-26. I also wanted to ask that we might consider what it means for us to be people of the Word of God. What does it mean for us to be guided and led, as Don was praying, by the Spirit? How are we led by the Spirit? Is it simply how we feel? Is that what the Spirit does, what our gut tells us? Really, in our tradition, we feel like we are led by the Spirit when we are led by the Word of God, right? The Scripture, the Bible, the written Word of God. the gift that the Spirit has given to us is this inspired, authoritative, infallible, and inerrant word. So I encourage us to be students of this, and I am going somewhere with that. So there are two adult Sunday school classes happening right after this. Plenty of room for all of us to be there. One is in Fellowship Hall and one is in the chapel. I encourage you, if you aren't in Sunday school, on Wednesday nights we are studying online. And we are going through the seven deadly sins. I know that's not a great invitation, but it's still an invitation for you. We had about 30 people online this Wednesday. And also there's a children's study on Wednesdays as well at 6:30 online. So please look for that information. As we turn to the Word of God, let me pray for us. Thank you, God, for the gift of your Word. A word that is full of truth and grace. A written word that points to the living word who is Jesus. So open up our minds and our hearts to be receptive, not simply to grow in knowledge, but to gain wisdom, to live in obedience, to follow you with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. So the Word of God from Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 through 26. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and its desires. And since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking and envying one another. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So last week we talked about the fruit of the Spirit and we addressed the issue of love in a short way. But I want to remind us that what we learned about love is that love comes from God. Love isn't something that we stir up within ourselves. And without God, there is no love. So in order to know what love is, we need to know who God is. And that's the same truth for each of these characteristics of the fruit of the Spirit. This morning, we're going to talk about joy and peace. And let me just suggest again from the very beginning that it says that it's a fruit of the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God. So there might be a worldly joy or a worldly peace. That's not what God is talking about here. What God is talking about here is the joy and the peace that have as its source and beginning the Spirit of God. So it's God's joy, God's peace. I don't say that to want to distinguish too much, but I say it because I do want to distinguish it very much, that it's completely different. As the world looks for these things, they're looking in all kinds of places. And often these days, we look to ourselves to create joy or to bring peace. And there isn't anything wrong with that, but let me just say it's temporary and it's fleeting. If the joy and the peace that we seek to create have its beginning in us and not in who God is in Christ Jesus. For example, there are often times in our world and in our experience of life that the desire for people is to be happy, right? Don't worry, be happy. In fact, I hear oftentimes from people the phrase about that, what I really want for that person is that they are happy. Really, what I want for my child is happiness. And I cringe at that. Not because it's not heartfelt and real, but I think they mean something different than happiness. I hope they mean something different than happiness. Because happiness is defined as when circumstances or situations around you are the way you would want them to be. And then you can be happy. So it's totally determined by what's outside of you, what's happening around you. So can you be happy in the midst of turmoil and trouble? Not really, not by its definition. But I would suggest you can have joy always, regardless of the circumstance or the situation. And let's take the word peace also. Everybody wants peace, world peace. Let there be peace, let it begin with me. We sing that all the time. Again, I don't want to say that that's horrible, but it's not a biblical understanding of peace. Peace doesn't begin with us, it begins with God. It begins with God. And real peace, everlasting peace, peace that doesn't ebb and flow, that has its rootedness in the character of God and in our understanding of God. So even as we pray for peace in Ukraine, amen, we should be doing that. And it's right and good for people to make treaties and do worldly things that stop killing and cease violence. I get that. But that killing and that violence is going to repeat itself over and over and over again until we come to the place where we're ready to acknowledge God in it all. Until we're ready to acknowledge God. And not just us, but everyone else. So I really do think, and I believe with my whole heart, that the quickest way to peace is evangelism. That the quickest way to peace is for people to come to a saving knowledge, a transformed life, in a relationship with Jesus. And to understand what God has done in His Son, who is Savior and Lord. We work at those other things. Don't get me wrong. I am not putting that down. We need to work at that world peace. But that world peace ebbs and flows by circumstances and situations. The peace that God is talking about here in the fruit of the Spirit is the peace that does not change with the tide or the current. It's a peace that is stable. And so I want us to look at a few passages that help us understand these two things. I'm going to start with the peace part, and it's in John 14. Let me read to you from verses 25 and following. All this I have spoken while still with you. These are the words of Jesus. But the Counselor, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you. So Jesus is saying, he's preparing his friends for his departure. He's dying, he's leaving. But as he dies and ascends to heaven, he says, you won't be left alone. The Father, we will send the Holy Spirit, and the Spirit will remind you of all things and teach you of everything that I have said. And then here is the very next word. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. You see where the peace comes from? Peace I leave with you. The peace is the peace of Jesus that he has. His peace he leaves with his disciples. His peace he gives to those who will believe. It's not something we achieve or obtain. It's a gift that comes from Jesus to us. And the next word he says is this: I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Do not let them be afraid. So if we're lacking peace in our life, then we need to ask where we're looking for that peace from. Are we looking for it from how the situation is? Or are we looking for peace from Jesus? Earlier in that very chapter, 14 verse 1, he says this. He repeats or says for the first time, do not let your hearts be troubled. And then he says this, trust in God, trust also in me. So I believe that our peace is connected to this trusting in God and trusting in Christ. Not trusting in ourselves, not trusting in the world as it is, but trusting in God Himself. So think about that when you are feeling unsettled in your own life. Think about that where times are troubled, right? Perhaps relationships where things aren't smooth or peaceful. Why? Why are they not peaceful for you? And how can they be peaceful for you? There are many, many examples, but often we are troubled because life isn't going the way we had hoped for ourselves or for someone else. And so we are troubled. Rightly so, don't get me wrong, that we should grieve when things aren't well with people. But in the midst of that grief, there is still the possibility and the promise that we can have peace if we trust Jesus, if we trust God with that situation. Let's just take an example. If you are worried about your adult child or your young adult child or your even younger child, and you are troubled about their behavior, their decision-making, how they're living their life, doesn't mean that we say, oh, everything is okay, I'm at peace. But in the midst of that, can you trust God to be sovereign, not just in your own life, but in theirs, even in the midst of the trouble, even in the middle of the turmoil? Can you trust your child to God and trust God with your child? Or do you have to make everything right for him or her? Warning, you can't. And you'll get more frustrated. That doesn't mean we're irresponsible, but it means we trust them to God and trust God with them. There are many of us who have or are dealing with parents, perhaps, who are aging, maybe losing some of their memory, falling down that path of dementia or Alzheimer's or just not so with it. And it's very, very troubling. It's so often that I visit with folks who are in that situation, and particularly if they're together, their mom or dad says something that doesn't make any sense at all. It's not correct. It's off the wall. And that adult child feels the necessity to need to correct their parent, to make it right, because it would give that adult child peace to make sure their parent got it right. Let me just say this, friends. Trust God that your parent doesn't have to be right. They don't have to have their facts in order. They don't have to have names and places properly adjudicated in their mind. They don't even have to remember who you are. You can still have peace as you trust God with their journey, and as you trust them into God's hands. Flip it around. What if you're the adult and your child is doing things that aren't right and they're wrong and they're making poor decisions? And you and I, believe me, I'm with you in this, want to correct them, want to show them the right way, want to help them make better decisions. It's not that we shouldn't, but our peace doesn't come from them making right decisions, doing it the way we would do it. Our peace comes from trusting them into God's hands and trusting God with who they are, who they'll become, what they're doing. That's the peace that God is talking about here. That peace comes from nothing and no one else but the Spirit of God. The world can't do that for you. The world can't do that for us. Only God can. So what about joy? What about this issue of joy? Let me read from John 16. Verses 19 and following, 19 to 24. Jesus saw that his disciples wanted to ask him about this, and he said to them, "Are you asking one another what I meant when I said, 'In a little while you will see me no more, and then after a little while you will see me'? I tell you the truth, you will weep and mourn while the world rejoices. You will grieve." Hear this. Listen. You will grieve. First of all, acknowledge that, right? There is grief. You will grieve, but your grief will turn to joy. A woman giving birth to a child has pain because her time has come. But when her baby is born, she forgets the anguish because of her joy that a child is born into the world. So with you. Now is your time of grief, but I will see you again, and you will rejoice, and no one will take away your joy. In that day, you will no longer ask me anything. I tell you the truth. My Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. Until now, you have not asked for anything in my name. Ask and you will receive, and your joy will be complete. He's saying, I'm going to be going away and I'll be coming back. And it's right to grieve while I'm gone, but there will be great joy that cannot be taken away when I return. So I want to acknowledge, joy is not the absence of grief. Just as peace is not the absence of conflict. Peace is the presence of God in the midst of conflict. Joy is also the gift of God in the midst of grief and sorrow and trouble and mourning. We should grieve, but listen to this. Can we grieve with hope? Can we grieve with hope? Hope in the joy that is to come and will be complete. So joy is our anticipation of God fulfilling His promise in the end, even while we're on our way. And I want to say this just as an encouragement to you as well. And I don't have a biblical passage for this, but it's just my experience. That even as I grieve, or you grieve, the anticipation of joy can carry us through that valley. The anticipation of joy. And for me, I would say that anticipation of joy allows me to experience or know that joy in part even already, even though it's not complete. so I or you can have joy even in grief or before is fulfilled and satisfied. That's what we want to remember. The whole world wants this joy and this peace. They're looking for it, and we often look for it in the wrong places and from the wrong people. Joy isn't something we just get from someone else. It's something that comes from our trust and belief in God, our obedience to God. Peace is the same. Finally, just a few more practical applications for this. Oftentimes, the world and us look for peace in our happiness in our work or our job. That's what we think should make us happy. But if you have your joy in Christ, you take that joy into your job, your vocation, so that you don't depend or need that to make you happy or have joy. Sometimes we look for peace in a relationship, in a marriage, between a parent and a child. I'll have peace when or if this all comes together. The minute we depend upon our wife or our husband or our child or our parent for that peace, then we have put a condition on that peace. When in reality, if we have our peace in Christ and we bring that peace into our marriage, into our relationship, God is honored and glorified through that. So rather than looking for these attributes in the world and in our circumstance, we find these attributes as we walk with Jesus in trust and obedience. Joy and peace are a fruit of trust and obedience to God, not conditioned upon our situation. And again, let's not be like the world and look for these in other places, but know that they are found in Christ and in Christ alone. Let's pray together. God of grace, your Holy Spirit is a gift. Not only does the Advocate remind us of the teaching of Jesus, but the Spirit produces fruit in our lives. And as we are led by the Spirit and walk by the Spirit, we can know and have joy and peace that are so fleeting in the world as they seek it in circumstances or situations or by their own power. Allow us to be humble, to turn toward you, to be open for you to fill us anew, that we might live that new life in Christ, that our joy would be complete and our peace unwavering. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand and sing our final hymn together, friends.
Thank you.
Beloved, as we go out into the world, know that wherever you are going this week, it is not by accident, it is not a coincidence, but God is sending you there. You are not going to find joy and peace in that place. God wants you to take joy and peace into that place and to be the presence of God for that person, to be the witness of Jesus Christ by having joy where there's trouble and knowing peace when there's conflict. That comes from walking in the Spirit, from knowing Christ and His promise. Remember, nothing separates us from the love of God that we know in Jesus. And it is God's grace in the gift of His Son, our Savior, the life, death, resurrection, the promised return. That is our hope. He is our salvation. May the Holy Spirit so bear this good fruit in your life that you will be a light in the darkness, pointing to Jesus, who is the hope for peace now and forever. Amen. Let's read our benediction response. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. Amen.